Hi, and welcome to this class on music inspired by birdsong. You've just heard a very famous piece of music that imitates birds singing. It's the second movement, By the Brook, of Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony. Beethoven identified the birds in the score, the nightingale played on the flute, the quail on the oboe, and the cuckoo played on two clarinets. Let me introduce myself. I'm Rob Arnold. For the past 12 or so years, I've given many different music classes for OLLI, but this is my first attempt at an online class. I'm a retired professor of biology from Colgate University in Hamilton, New York. I've had a lifelong passion for music for at least 70 of my 78 years. I enjoy music of all kinds, although I've never gotten into heavy metal or rap. My major interest is in English music of the two so-called Golden Ages, the 16th to 17th centuries and the 20th century. My interest in birds is part of an overall love of nature, and developing this course has allowed me to combine love of music and of birds. There are essentially three ways in which birds and bird song are used in music. Firstly, there are compositions where actual recordings of bird song are integrated into instrumental music. For example, in The Pines of Rome by Ottorino Respighi, the third movement, The Pines of the Janiculum, calls for a pre-recorded nightingale song. Secondly, there are compositions where birdsong is imitated by musical instruments, often with variations and elaboration. We just heard an example of this, the imitations of the nightingale, quail, and cuckoo in Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony. In this case, the identity of the bird is immediately obvious. But in other examples, it is much less obvious or impossible to discern because the composer may have used a single facet of the bird song, such as a rhythmic idea, in the composition. Then thirdly, there are compositions, usually songs, where birds are mentioned in the title or lyrics, but where no attempt is made to make the music sound like the bird call or song. For example, Fly Like an Eagle by the Steve Miller Band, Skyline Pigeon by Elton John. Also, there are many, many songs where the bird isn't named. Bird on a Wire by Leonard Cohen, Three Little Birds by Bob Marley, for example. We'll see examples of all three. I've chosen to begin this class with the common blackbird, which features in many pieces of music. This bird is similar to and in the same genus as the American robin. Both are thrushes in the family Turdidae. Red-winged blackbirds, however, are in a different family. The icteridae. Common blackbirds are gregarious, they're not at all shy of humans. Like American robins, they are ground feeders. There is a division of labor, the female prepares the nest for the next brood, chicks are cared for mostly by males, however. The blackbird is fiercely territorial, but searches far afield for food. The map shows the distribution of the common blackbird. It's resident year-round throughout Europe, Turkey, extreme northwest Africa, and, oddly, Kazakhstan. Its range is extended in summer to Russia and southern Scandinavia. Its winter range includes Iran. It's been introduced into New Zealand and extreme southeastern Australia. There's an interesting story of the culture and history of the blackbird. In the year 618 in Ireland, a little-known man called Kevin, later St. Kevin of Glendalough, was apparently in prayer in his monastery with one hand outstretched to the heavens when a blackbird flew down, built a nest on his hand, and laid an egg. According to legend, he was in such intense prayer with outstretched hands that the egg eventually hatched, and ever since he's been called the patron saint of the blackbird. He must have remained motionless in prayer for 13 to 14 days for all this to happen. Today this would be in the Guinness Book of Records. The way that birds produce their songs and calls is very interesting and is shown in the diagram on this slide. The syrinx, or voice box, is the vocal organ of birds. It's more developed and complex in birds with more elaborate songs. Air flowing through the syrinx sets up vibrations in the walls, and the sound is modulated by muscles in the walls. The two branches can be modulated differently. This allows for a much greater variety of sounds and sound qualities. Most birds have a relatively immobile tongue, which means they can't make the complex sounds necessary to form words. Parrots and their relatives are obvious exceptions to this. Like other birds, blackbirds are taught phrases by their fathers and other adult males in the vicinity. This happens in most bird species only in the earliest months of life, then the song becomes fixed. Blackbirds, however, learn new songs each breeding season. The song has a mixture of melodic and noisy elements. This video shows a blackbird singing in the evening. I'll use the blackbird to illustrate the three ways birdsong is used in musical compositions, which I mentioned earlier. Firstly, I'll present the Beatles song Blackbird from the White Album of 1968. In this song, a recording of a blackbird singing is added in the last verse. Paul McCartney writes about why he wrote the song. "I was in Scotland, playing on my guitar, and I remembered this whole idea of you were only waiting for this moment to arise was about the black people's struggle in the southern states, and I was using the symbolism of a blackbird. It's not really about a blackbird whose wings are broken, you know. It's a bit more symbolic."
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly, into the line of a dark black night. Singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise.
Secondly, I discussed how birdsong is imitated by musical instruments. An example of this, again using the blackbird, is a piece called Le Merle Noir, the blackbird in other words, by the French composer Olivier Messiaen. The composer had a lifelong interest in ornithology, particularly bird songs, and we'll meet him again later in this class. The piece incorporates a stylized song, but one that is still recognizable. It's played here on the flute by Christian Laudet, accompanied by the composer's wife, Yvonne Loriot, on the piano.
Thank you.
Thirdly, there's the situation where a particular bird, again the blackbird in this example, is named in the title or lyrics of a song. When I was in elementary school, we had an assembly each morning at which we used to sing various hymns and English folk songs, along with announcements and talks by the head teacher. One of the hymns, Morning Has Broken, made a huge impression on me that I retain to this day. It's a Christian hymn, first appeared in a publication, Songs of Praise, of 1931, which is used in many churches throughout the UK for many years. The words are by Eleanor Fargeon, inspired by the village of Alfriston in East Sussex, UK. It was written in response to a request from the publisher of Songs of Praise to write a poem that would fit the lovely Scottish tune Bunnison from the Scottish Islands. It was popularised by Cat Stevens in the 1971 album Teaser and the Firecat, but here I present it in the original hymn version that we used to sing at school. Olivier Messiaen has done much more with birdsong than any other composer because of a passion for ornithology and music. Initially, he crisscrossed France, sometimes sleeping in the rough and often risking serious injury in his quest to see and hear as many species as possible. He then observed and recorded in musical notation birdsongs in France, Southeast Asia, South America, Australia, and the United States. What set him apart from other keen birders was his ability to transform the melodic outline and rhythms of birdsong into notated music. He also used commercial recordings of birdsongs, such as were found in Ludwig Koch's Songs of Wild Birds of 1936 and Songs of British Birds of 1953. Koch was a broadcaster and sound recordist. He was an expert on recording animal sounds and played a significant part in increasing the British public's appreciation of wildlife. Messiaen often needed to slow down the tempo or lower the pitch of a bird call or song. He explained, I quote, "A bird, being much smaller than we are, with a heart that beats faster and nervous reactions that are much quicker, sings in extremely swift tempos, absolutely impossible for our instruments. I am therefore obliged to transcribe the song into a slower tempo. Moreover, this rapidity is combined with an extreme shrillness, for birds are able to sing in extremely high registers that cannot be reproduced on our instruments. So I write one, two, or even three octaves lower." Interestingly, Messiaen also experienced a neurological condition called synesthesia. This is defined as a condition in which one sense, for example hearing, is simultaneously perceived as if by one or more additional senses, such as sight. Another form of synesthesia joins objects such as letters, shapes, numbers, or people's names with a sensory perception, such as smell, color, or flavor. In Messiaen's case, the condition meant that he associated sounds with color. Whenever he heard an E major chord, for example, his mind would be flooded with sunset red. This phenomenon of synesthesia is discussed by Oliver Sacks in his 2007 book, Musicophilia. Here's the first example on my list of Messiaen's works about birds. Abyss of the Birds, for clarinet, is a movement from his Quartet for the End of Time, written in 1940 and first performed on a frigid night in January 1941 while Messiaen was a prisoner of war at a camp in Silesia. Makes an interesting story. The quartet is in eight movements, written for clarinet, violin, cello, and piano. The work's instrumentation was determined by the instruments and performers at hand. Three other professional musicians, clarinetist Henri Acoca, violinist Jean Le Boulair, and cellist Étienne Pesquier were among his fellow prisoners. After he managed to obtain some paper and a small pencil from a sympathetic guard, Messiaen set to work. He initially wrote a short trio for his three campmates. that this piece developed into the quartet for the same trio with himself at the piano. Combination of instruments is unusual, but not without precedent. Paul Hindemith composed his quartet for the same combination. Messiaen later described the work's premiere. The stalag was buried in snow. We were 30,000 prisoners, French for the most part, with a few Poles and Belgians. The four musicians played on broken instruments. The keys on my upright piano remained lowered when depressed. It's on this piano, with my three fellow musicians, dressed in the oddest way, completely tattered, and wooden clogs large enough for the blood to circulate despite the snow underfoot. It was on this piano that I played my quartet. We'll now hear a short extract from Abyss of the Birds, played by Gervaise de Paya. This list contains the remaining major works by Messiaen featuring bird song. We've already met Le Merle Noir, the blackbird, Réveil des oiseaux, literally waking up birds, describes birds singing in the morning hours in the Jura region of France. Oiseau exotique, for piano and small orchestra, surveys more than 40 birds of India, China, Malaysia, and North and South America. Catalogue d'oiseaux for solo piano surveys 13 birds of Europe. The Canyon aux Étoiles, from the canyons to the stars, of interest to American audiences, is a massive 90-minute work for large orchestra. It was commissioned by Alice Tully to celebrate the bicentenary of the United States Declaration of Independence. The music derives from a visit Messiaen made to Utah, where he was inspired by the birds and the landscape, particularly at colorful Bryce Canyon. Birds include the mockingbird, the wood thrush, and the white-browed robin. One of the movements features the birds of Hawaii. Let me make a brief digression to introduce the use of spectrograms to describe bird calls and songs. A spectrogram is a visual representation of the spectrum of frequencies of a signal, in this case a bird call or song, as it varies with time. Different bird species have very different spectrograms. Even within a species, the spectrogram can differ among individuals and at different seasons. Let's start with an easy example. The black-capped chickadee. This is its call. And this is its spectrogram. The vertical axis of the spectrogram is frequency, or pitch, in kilohertz. The horizontal axis is time, in seconds. The song runs from left to right. High-pitched notes near the top and low-pitched notes are farther below. The horizontal width of each note determines how long it lasts, anywhere from a fraction of a second to several seconds. The shape indicates quality. A whistle looks like a single, nearly horizontal line. The nasal sound produces a bunch of horizontal lines stacked on top of one another. Note that the spectrogram of the black-capped chickadee shows two notes, the first higher in pitch than the second. It also shows a very slight break about halfway through the second note in the call. You can hear this break in the chickadee's call. The chickadee doesn't say, hey, sweet, but rather, hey, sweetie. Did you notice the break in the call? This shows how a spectrogram can help your eyes to focus the ears more acutely. Let's listen to the call again to make sure you hear the slight break. When we compare Messiaen's written notes with the spectrogram of a particular bird, we often find a close match. For example, here's the song of the Northern Cardinal from Messiaen's Oiseau Exotique of 1956. This allows us to compare the written notes, piano performance, and the spectrogram. First, here's the actual call of the Northern Cardinal. Here's Messiaen's piece, played by Yvonne Loriot. That went by very quickly. Let's hear it again. My next musical choice is the Titwillow song from Gilbert and Sullivan's operetta, The Mikado. I include it even though it's the only piece of music I know that has anything to do with members of the European tit family, but I'm a real Gilbert and Sullivan fan and I wanted to include this song. It's not clear which of the European tits is the focus of this song. There's the blue tit, the great tit, or the willow tit. The words titwillow might suggest the willow tit, but this bird is extremely rare, and it's unlikely that Gilbert or Sullivan would have heard of it. Also, the words little tom tit in the song are what would be used to talk about a blue tit. So I'm going to say it's likely to be the much more common blue tit and talk about that bird. The photograph of the pair in this slide shows the slightly brighter male on the left. The blue tit is one of the conspicuous British birds I learnt to recognise as a small child. It's the only British bird with blue in its plumage. It's widespread throughout Europe and extending into North Africa and Turkey. Its habitat is broad-leaved woodlands, but it's very adaptable and often found in a variety of other habitats, including gardens. Individual birds very rarely move more than a few miles from where they hatched. Most commonly, it nests in holes in trees, but may be found in mailboxes or street lamps. The birds feed on insects and seeds. The male keeps up a constant twittering call. So here's the Gilbert and Sullivan song. The Mikado has a complicated story, like most Gilbert and Sullivan operettas. The Mikado, or Emperor of Japan, has introduced a law whereby any man who flirts gets his head cut off. Officials in the town of Titipu concoct a scheme whereby the next in line for execution, an individual called Coco, is released from prison and made Lord High Executioner, on the pretext that, since he's next in line and the executioner, he, in the words of the song, can't cut off another's head until he's cut his own off, which is impossible to do. After several years, the Mikado and Katisha, an elderly lady in the Mikado's court, visit Titipu. The Mikado complains about the lack of executions in Titipu, threatening Coco with torture and beheading unless someone is executed forthwith. Coco then offers to marry Katisha, who most people think is, quote, something appalling, to prevent his own execution and that of several others in the court. He woos her with this song. At first, Katisha wants nothing to do with him, but she is gradually won over.
On a tree by a river, a little tomtit sang willow, tit willow, tit willow. And I said to him, Dickie bird, why do you sit singing willow, tit willow, tit willow? Is it weakness of intellect, birdie, I cried, or a rather tough worm in your little inside? With a shake of his poor little head, he replied, oh, willow, tit willow. Slept at his chest as he sat on that bough, singing willow, tit willow, tit willow. And a cold perspiration bespangled his brow, oh willow, tit willow, tit willow. He sobbed and he sighed, and a gurgle he gave. Then he plunged himself into the billowy wave. And an echo arose from the suicide's grave. Oh, willow, tit willow. Now I feel just as sure as I'm sure that my name isn't willow, tit willow, tit willow. That was blighted affection that made him exclaim, oh willow, tit willow, tit willow. And if you remain callous and obdurate, I shall perish as he did, and you will know why, though I probably shall not exclaim as I die. Oh willow, tit willow.
The common cuckoo is probably featured in music more frequently than any other bird is. It's also imitated by cuckoo clocks. It's interesting that the other 53 species of cuckoo don't make the cuckoo sound. The common cuckoo is the only one. It feeds on insects. Its favorite food is the hairy caterpillar stage of the garden tiger moth. The common cuckoo spends summers in Europe and Asia, and winters in Southern Africa and Southeast Asia. It sings only in the summer. The common cuckoo is a brood parasite. 90% of cuckoo eggs are laid in the nests of reed warbler, meadow pipit, and dunnock birds. The remaining 10% are distributed among a variety of other birds. It lays one egg per nest, 12 to 22 eggs per season. The cuckoo nestling after hatching pushes the eggs and nestlings of the host bird out of the nest until it's the only survivor, who is then fed and taken care of as if it were the host bird's own. Here's the familiar cuckoo call. This list shows examples of music inspired by the cuckoo. It's quite a long list. We already heard the cuckoo in Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony at the beginning of the class. So here we look at two other examples, the song Summer is a Comin' In and On Hearing the First Cuckoo in Spring by Frederick Delius. The song Summer is a Comin' In dates from the mid-13th century and is one of the oldest known songs in English. It's a roto, or round, where one voice starts and others join in at intervals. Those already singing continue. The song is about surviving the winter and making it through the period where, in medieval times, food could be scarce and life could be hard. There's no relationship between the English and the Latin words, which are shown in red or in the insert on the page. These are not about cuckoos or nature, but instead convey a religious message. There's disagreement about the pronunciation and meaning of the word shown in red in the eighth line of this song. This is rendered into modern English as verteth. This can mean either turns or cavorts, something bucks are known to do, or it may mean farts, which is something else bucks are known to do.
How I bled it after long, those after pound a coo. Wullem stertet, mucke vertet, myre sing cuckoo. Sing cuckoo, cuckoo. Well, who sing as cuckoo, as sweet to never who. Sing cuckoo.
Summer is the comedy, summer is the comedy.
Traube sing to blow with men, and spring to put the noise.
Sing cuckoo de noo.
In the cuckoo song, the interval between the two sounds, cu and coo, is interesting. This is illustrated by the cuckoo rhyme, one version of which is, the cuckoo comes in April, it sings its song in May, in the middle of June it changes its tune, and in July it flies away. What we find is that the musical interval between the two successive notes, cu and coo, varies with time of year. The cuckoo in our recording that we've just heard goes from F to D, which is a minor third. If you look at the diagram of the piano keyboard there, this shows that a minor third is three half steps. F to E is one half step, E to D sharp is a second, D sharp to D is a third half step. This interval is typical of cuckoos in the spring. Let me illustrate what this chord sounds like. The two call notes of the cuckoo in the video we just saw are a minor third apart, again F to D. Later in summer, the call tends to be a major third, made up of four half steps. Here's what this interval sounds like. The notes are F to C sharp. The first note of the cuckoo's call is usually in the range D to F, with the second note a minor third, major third, or occasionally even a fourth below. Cuckoos don't necessarily start exactly on one of these notes, however. Cuckoos don't use our musical scales. There's evidence that differences in calls among cuckoos is used in recognition of familiar versus unfamiliar individuals. The next piece of music inspired by the cuckoo was written by one of my favorite composers, Frederick Delius. The piece is On Hearing the First Cuckoo in Spring. Delius was born in Bradford, Yorkshire in 1862 of German parents. His father was in the wool trade. He wanted his son to join him, but Delius resisted all attempts. Frederick wanted only to study and compose music. His father felt that to be a waste of time and was without prospects. They reached an impasse. Finally, his father, feeling his son needed to do something with his life, anything but music, sent him to Florida at age 22 to manage an orange plantation at Solano Grove near Jacksonville. Frederick stayed there for 2 years, focusing on music but not on growing oranges, until his father found out and ordered him home. Delius's early compositions reflected music he heard from African-American singers in Florida and of European composers including Wagner and Grieg. Later, he developed his own unique style of chromatic harmony and languid expression, showing the influence of Debussy. It's been said that many composers have reflected on nature, but in the expression of nature's tranquillities, Delius excelled all others. He's usually claimed as an English composer, but in fact he's too cosmopolitan for that, having visited Norway and Germany extensively and living for most of his adult life in France. He visited England only rarely and then on sufferance. He died in 1934 and, by his own request, is buried in the grounds of a small church in the English village of Limpsfield, Sussex. The first Cuckoo in Spring has an overall melancholy, reflecting Delius's regret that the springtime of life passes all too soon. This sadness is suggested by a series of descending notes at the beginning of the piece, like the cuckoo's call. After a woodwind introduction, the strings play part of In Ola Valley, a Norwegian folk song collected by Delius's friend and mentor, Edvard Grieg, who incidentally intervened with Frederick's father on Delius's return to the UK from Florida so that a small stipend to support his musical endeavors was agreed on. Early in the piece, the clarinet imitating the cuckoo plays a series of minor thirds from C sharp to A sharp, an interval typical of early spring. At the end of the piece, the music fades into a regretful silence as the cuckoo leaves to fly south. The nightingale is famous for the beauty and variety of its song. It's able to produce more than 1,000 different sounds, in excess of 200 songs. The songs are rich in trills and whistles. Nightingales sing both at night to attract females and during the day to maintain a territory. They usually sing from dense cover and are hard to see. Many more people have heard a nightingale than have seen one. Males and females are hard to tell apart. Nightingales spend the winters in sub-Saharan Africa. They spend the summers in much of Europe south of Scandinavia and eastwards across Turkey, reaching the borders of China and Afghanistan. The nest is usually on the ground in densely vegetated areas. Next is a short video of nightingales singing in a sunny woodland. If we were to have listened to this recording for several minutes, we'd have heard a bigger variety of sounds and songs than you can hear in a short recording like this one. Beatrice Harrison, a famous cellist, used to practice in the garden of her home in Sussex. One day she noticed a nightingale singing along with her. She convinced the BBC in 1924 that staff members needed to join her in her garden as she practiced playing her instrument and make a recording. The BBC agreed and engineers set up bulky equipment to go live. No bird sang. Then, 15 tense minutes before the end of the broadcast, the nightingale started chirping. This was the first time that wildlife had been recorded and broadcast by the BBC, and it captured the public's heart. The recording we'll hear features a short clip from one of the BBC broadcasts. You can hear the nightingale singing along with Beatrice as she plays Dvorak's songs My Mother Taught Me. Not surprisingly, the nightingale has inspired many composers to write works expressing the vocal prowess of this bird. Most don't contain imitations of the song, however. We'll hear four examples, the last of which uses the organ to imitate both the nightingale and the cuckoo. Firstly, a troubadour song composed by Geoffrey Rudel. Troubadours were medieval French lyric poets composing and singing in a dialect of Occitan called Provençal in the 11th to 13th centuries. Occitan is the Romance language of southern France and some parts of Catalonia and Italy. It's still spoken in those regions, but is slowly disappearing. Troubadour songs are mainly monophonic, that is, they consist of a single musical line, but were often accompanied by one or two instruments. They have simple melodies and intricately beautiful lyrics that were traditional expressions of courtly love, which was the basis of most troubadour songs. Courtly love celebrated the romantic devotion to a sexually unattainable woman, usually the wife of another man. Manuscripts survive that show the tune to which troubadour poems were sung, but we know almost nothing about the instrumental accompaniment. What we have here is the performing group's idea of what the accompaniment may have sounded like based on knowledge of performance practices at the time. We can clearly hear the nightingale singing in the woodwind accompaniment to this song. We'll now hear Geoffrey Rudell's song, Quan Lo Rossinhol.
Caloro signore, fuglio. Dona d'amor, en quien en breve. Emu, sun chan jause. Remira sa par suve el riu sun clar el prat sun ge per nuvel de por che regna al cor gran jois chasi
We know nothing of the life of Jane Pickering. In fact, it's pure good luck that we know her name, for the first section of the manuscript has been lost, the damage narrowly missing the folio containing her signature and the date 1616. However, Jane's manuscript still conveys a vivid impression of her musical taste, which was conservative, emphasizing music from late Elizabethan times a few decades earlier. Her technical attainment on the lute, which was high level, and even the type of lute she owned. Most of the pieces in the collection are written for six-course lute. The photograph at left shows a six-course Renaissance lute. The term courses is used because most of what we call strings are in fact paired. In this lute, the highest pitched course at right is a single string. The other strings are double. The second, third, and fourth courses are each composed of paired strings in unison. The fifth and sixth courses are paired strings tuned an octave apart, which softens the sound compared with two strings in unison. The inset in the Renaissance lute photograph shows a close-up of the six courses, 11 strings in total. In the later Baroque period, lutes were built with more and more strings, culminating in 13-course lutes. This was likely an attempt by lute makers and players to compete with the harpsichord, which grew in popularity through the Baroque period and threatened to displace the lute. This, in fact, happened. Note that the harpsichord, in turn, was subsequently displaced by the piano. Given the effort needed to get the 25 strings of a Baroque lute in tune in those days where strings were made of catgut, which didn't hold tension for long, you can understand the origin of the saying that if a lute player lived for 80 years, he'd have spent 60 of them tuning his lute. The lute duet, Le Rossignol, is played here by Martin Best and Edward Flower.
Thank you.
Nightingales don't sing in Berkeley Square, right in the middle of Mayfair in London's West End. They never have. They prefer the dense shade of woodlands. Eric Mashvitz, the lyricist, knew very well that Berkeley Square was the last place on earth you'd expect to hear a nightingale. But we must agree with him that it's a great song, performed here by Vera Lynn, who gained the title Force's Sweetheart from her frequent appearances during World War II to perform before troops close to the front line, with favorite songs such as We'll Meet Again. The photograph at right shows an illuminated wire sculpture of a nightingale displayed in London's Berkeley Square as part of the art festival Lumiere London in 2018. The sculpture and the accompanying soundtrack, A Nightingale Sang in Berkeley Square, formed an art installation titled Was That a Dream? By the French artist Cédric Le Borgne. Here's the song.
That certain night, the night we met, there was magic abroad in the air. There were angels dining at the Ritz, and a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square. I may be right, I may be wrong, but I'm perfectly willing to swear that when you turned and smiled at me, a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square.
This Handel concerto is in Italian style, like those pioneered by Corelli and Vivaldi, who transformed the concerto into one dominated by strings with a unique sound provided by the harpsichord and sometimes the organ, the so-called Italian style. The second movement of this concerto is a chirpy allegro. In it, the organ imitates the call of the cuckoo and the lyrical song of the nightingale, first each bird alone and then as a duet. The skylark is one of the most famous songbirds in the world, celebrated by poets and naturalists. It occurs throughout Europe. English settlers in North America tried repeatedly to introduce the skylark, but succeeded only on southern Vancouver Island, British Columbia. It's been present in British Columbia in the early 1900s, and there are still a few skylarks around the edges of Victoria on Vancouver Island, but they're gradually disappearing as development takes over their habitat. Males and females have similar plumage. Males are slightly larger. They feed on seeds and insects. They build cup-shaped nests of matted grass on the ground. I have a vivid memory from when I was about 7 years old of a skylark singing on the Yorkshire moors when I was on a walk with my grandmother on a sunny but windy day. Our walking disturbed a skylark, which flew up from the ground and proceeded to fly vigorously against the wind, not making much progress, but singing its heart out. The next video shows a skylark's song. we'll look at two musical works inspired by the skylark. First, a troubadour song. Bernat de Ventadorn is one of the best known troubadour composers. Over 45 of his poems survive, 18 of them with music. Like Geoffrey Roudel, he wrote lyric poetry in Provençal. He was the son of a servant in the castle of Ventadorn in south central France and learnt to sing and write poetry. His songs have, and I quote, an exquisite marriage of beautiful melody and hopelessness. He fell in love with the wife of the lord of the castle, and she with him, and he wrote songs for her. Next, he had a love affair with Eleanor of Aquitaine, during which time he continued to write many songs. This affair ended when Eleanor moved to England to marry King Henry II. Bernat later died in a monastery. Can vai la lausetta mover is perhaps Bernat's most popular song.
Can vai la lausetta mover de gioia salas contra il re che solire stai sa sciazzer per la tua sor cal cor li vai. Ai, tan gran sen veamen vede quio che viaggi a Zion. Meraviglia sae car de se lo cor de desire vir non fo.
Each year, the British radio station Classic FM asks listeners to vote for their favourite classical piece. Some 100 to 150,000 listeners typically vote. The winner this year has won 9 times before. It's by my number one favourite composer, Ralph Vaughan Williams. The piece is The Lark Ascending. This piece is also by far the most often chosen piece in the BBC radio programme Desert Island Discs, over the 76 years of weekly broadcasts. In this program, a famous person from any walk of life, maybe from sport, from the arts, from politics, is asked to imagine he or she is to be marooned on a desert island. What 8 pieces of music would they want to have with them, assuming they had a music player, of course? What is the reason for each choice, and how does each piece of music fit into the person's life? The orchestral score of The Lark Ascending is prefaced by this poem by George Meredith. Here's the beginning of Vaughan Williams' piece. We're standing, perhaps, on the North Yorkshire moors on a hazy, dreamlike afternoon when a skylark arises from the ferns and grasses and flies upwards with its caroling song. In the last 30 seconds of this 2-minute extract, just as you think the lark is going to soar out of earshot, the main theme emerges from the lark's singing. The orchestra joins in with and punctuates the theme, contributing to the impressionistic haze of the summer afternoon. Many violinists have recorded this piece. Some of them may be greater virtuosos, but in my opinion, nobody captures the fluttering upward flight of the skylark quite like Iona Brown.
Thank you.
The middle section has a folk song-like tune, but it's an original composition. At the end of the piece, the solo lark ascends higher and flies away from us into the afternoon haze. At some point, its song is just at the edge of our hearing, then we no longer hear it. A favourite place for birders in the Arctic regions is Lake Leminka in Finland, just south of the Arctic Circle. A large variety of resident and migratory birds can be observed, especially in the short northern summers. Some of the more common birds of the Lake Leminka region are shown in the photographs on this slide. The piece Cantus Arcticus by Aino Juhani Rautavaara consists of three movements and uses recorded bird calls and songs from the region around Lake Leminka. We'll hear extracts of the first and third movements. The first movement, the bog, opens with a bird-like passage for two flutes. This is joined by the constant calling of nesting and feeding birds. Other woodwinds and strings are added. Then there's a sudden introduction of a somber melodic line accompanied by bird calls. The whole movement conveys a sense of desolation and loneliness.
Thank you.
Now we'll hear a portion of the third movement of Cantus Arcticus, Swans Migrating. This migration refers to that of the hooper swan. The extract here contains about a minute and a half close to the start of a 7-minute movement, a time when swans are gathering prior to migration. Then I've inserted a 2-second break. Then you'll hear the last 1.5 minutes or so of the piece when the swans are flying towards us overhead where they're very loud and then are receding into the distance. Lastly, in this survey of music inspired by birds, we come to hens and chicks. There are more than 60 breeds of poultry descended from various jungle fowls of India. They develop social hierarchies, what we call pecking orders. They were first domesticated 8,000 to 10,000 years ago, probably for religious reasons or for raising fighting birds. The widespread use of hens and chickens for meat and eggs didn't occur until the early 20th century. The chicken call sounds in the next slide are familiar to all of us. We'll look at extracts from these three pieces of music inspired by chickens. With the exception of the Mussorgsky piece, the videos that you'll see as the music plays were recorded by my wife during a recent trip to Key West, Florida. Firstly, La Poule, by Jean-Philippe Rameau, played here by Peter Hill on the harpsichord. Next, the Ballad of the Chickens in Their Shells from Modest Mussorgsky's Pictures at an Exhibition. Finally, Poules et Coqs from Le Carnaval des Animaux by Camille Saint-Saëns. Thank you for listening to this presentation, which I hope you've enjoyed. My understanding is that OLLI has made available a mechanism using email for questions and comments that you might otherwise have asked in class. Information about this should have been provided to you when you registered for the class. I hope you'll make use of this opportunity, and I will do my best to respond to all comments and questions you may have. Thanks.